Hi, for those of you I don't know, my name is Shawn Achor. I'm the author of The Happiness Advantage and Big Potential. And I know over the course of this incredible festival and conference that you have already heard from incredible luminaries about how if you change your habits, we can raise levels of happiness and how important happiness is within your life. So what I would like to do is to share research that doesn't cover the same ground. I want to talk about the thing that I'm most passionate about, that I think its importance has risen dramatically in the midst of the challenges our world has been experiencing over the past several months with COVID-19. So most people know me because of the Happiness Advantage. I gave a TED talk about 10 years ago and talked about how happiness, that if we could change our levels, our habits, if we changed a few habits within our life, your individual levels of happiness would rise. And if your happiness levels rise, well, then almost every single business and educational outcome improves dramatically. Happiness is an incredible advantage within our lives and one of the greatest competitive advantages in the modern economy, given all the challenges we're experiencing. What I was missing was I was treating happiness the wrong way. I was missing out on the majority of the formula, and that's the part I wanted to share with you. So I know people know me from the Happiness Advantage, but my favorite book, the message I would want to share with the world right now, comes from Big Potential, which came out 2 years ago, which almost no one knows about. And the reason for that is actually crucial to the research I want to share with you. So my wife was pregnant the year we were going to release Big Potential. This is 2 years ago. She was going to give birth to our daughter in April. So we decided that we would go on a book tour and have the book be released in early February. So you could go on a 3-week long book tour, you try and get it on a bestseller list, and then I could get off the road and then be there with my daughter and my wife and our son Leo. So during the first week of February, as Big Potential came out, during the first week of that of February, during the Super Bowl, while the Patriots were playing, my wife's water broke. Now, we didn't know that was what was going on at the time, and it was during the Super Bowl. So she Ubered to the hospital, husband of the year. I got her an XL, and she got there, and they said, ma'am, your water broke. You need to stay here for the next 6 weeks trying to hold this baby in, which also wasn't a thing. 3 days later, our daughter was born. Over the next 3 days, we almost lost her twice. She kept sparking back to life. We didn't even have a name for her at the time. Her name is Zoe Sparks Achor, and she's just celebrated her second birthday this year, and she's doing wonderfully. But instead of going on a 3-week long book tour to talk about this new research about how happiness and success are actually interconnected with other people around us, instead, for the next 50 days, my happiness sat in an incubator in NICU, being cared for by these angels who were caring for in a way that we couldn't possibly have cared for. I wasn't even allowed to touch Zoe for the first 2 weeks because my son was sick at the time. So my success rate at keeping Zoe alive would have been zero. But what we got to see was how much of our happiness and success was actually interrelated with the people around us. And we got to battle test the research that I want to share with you now that I think will be key to us being able to find a positive and adaptive way to be able to move forward and to shift the way that we even look and pursue happiness in a way that makes us stronger together. So I start the book with two stories, and those are the ones I want to share with you. The first one sounds boring, but I think it's life-changing. Two researchers out in Virginia discovered by accident that if you're looking at a hill that you need to climb in front of you, if you look at that hill by yourself, your brain actually shows you a picture of a hill. Your brain architects a picture of a hill that is 10 to 20% steeper than a hill of the same height that you perceive while standing next to someone who's gonna climb that hill with you. I know that's a little awkward way of saying it. What we're saying there is that the inclusion of someone else climbing that hill with you changed the hill that your brain saw by 20%. That shouldn't be happening. I always thought if I saw a hill in front of me, I could see how big it is, I see that challenge, and then I know whether or not I can climb it. That is not the way that human perception works. It turns out that whether or not you think you're with somebody or you're alone, overcoming a challenge dramatically changes the level of the challenge you see in front of you. And it's not just the physical ones, it's the emotional ones as well. Trying to overcome anxiety and depression, trying to find a job in the midst of the challenges we're seeing in the economy right now, trying to find a way of being able to care for our kids when they're home, being homeschooled in the midst of doing our work and the research that we're doing, trying to find some way of being able to create a positive impact upon other people's lives that are doing worse than our own. When we see those things, when we see those challenges, the more that we see them thinking that we're alone overcoming this or with other people dramatically changes it, which means that happiness cannot be self-help. As soon as we put positive psychology books, and the self-help section of a bookstore, we make happiness 10 to 20% steeper for people to achieve. Because the majority of our happiness is predicted by other people. It's predicted by our relationships with other people. One of the studies that I did back at Harvard when I was working with Dr. Tal Ben-Shahar, who was teaching the famed positive psychology course there, is that we were looking at what creates happiness, and the greatest predictor of a Harvard student's long-term levels of happiness was their social connection score. It was other people. So we can't pursue happiness alone when the greatest predictor of our happiness is other people. Now, we can actually achieve social connection even in the midst of what we've been calling social distancing, which is really physical distancing. Because we've been finding, for many people, myself included, my social connection scores have actually increased. My social connection has improved in the midst of this because I'm calling people or getting on Zoom calls or having Zoom dates with people or FaceTime calls and FaceTime dates with people that I normally don't get to because we need childcare, or I'm traveling every 3 days for work, or I'm being able to do, or I'm feeling too tired to get out of my introverted shell. What we're finding is in the midst of this, you can actually deepen social connection even in the midst of the challenges we've been experiencing in this world right now, which led to the second study from Big Potential. So in 1935, a biologist was going down a river in Southeast Indonesia. He was supposed to make it back to his camp before darkness fell, and he didn't make it back in time, which is a problem because here's this scrawny academic from the Pacific Northwest who had never left home before, came to Indonesia to study bugs, got very excited about studying some bugs, lost track of time, got back into his boat, and floated down the river with no lights in his boat, and floated right past the camp in the dark. So what made this, the historical record on this is hilarious, because this guy is sitting in this boat terrified, and he looks up at one of the mangrove trees lining the river, expecting to get eaten by a predator, and suddenly he said that the mangrove tree got struck by lightning. And then, as lightning never does, the same tree got struck by lightning again, and then again. And then, in this magical moment of nature, every single mangrove tree on one side of the river for 100 yards got struck by lightning at the exact same time, on one side of the river. And then again, and then again. When his faculties recovered and his vision recovered, he realized the lightning wasn't coming down from the sky, it was coming out from the trees. And what he realized was that these trees were covered with a swarm of bioluminescent lightning bugs, or fireflies, whatever you call them. And he studies bugs, he's an entomologist actually, and he was looking at these trees and he knows that they don't actually, they don't swarm. That's not what lightning bugs do. But they were covering every single inch of these mangrove trees for 100 yards. But what he reported seeing was the lightning bugs, instead of lighting up individually and randomly, like they do across the globe, the millions of them were lighting up and going dark simultaneously, simulating a lightning strike. He went back to the United States. He wrote up a scientific paper about the synchronous lightning bugs of Southeast Indonesia, and he almost lost his job. And the reason for that is, that's crazy. We know it's crazy because we thought we knew how the world works. It's survival of the fittest. You have to be the fastest, smartest, brightest light shining. Otherwise, you'll never rise up in the ranks. You'll never be successful. You'll never be rich, and then you can never be happy. Every part of that formula is scientifically broken and backwards, which if we had more time, we'd cover. But what I want to get to is this idea that the whole reason the biologists didn't believe him is the whole point of being a lightning bug is to light up in the dark to increase your chances of sexual reproduction. Why would you light up when everyone else is lit up? That's your competition, right? And the mathematician said it's impossible. For order to come out of chaos, someone has to lead it, right? So who's the one person getting millions of the lightning bugs to light up at the same time? Physically, mathematically, biologically, impossible for this to be occurring. 8 decades later, about 5 years ago, two researchers at MIT discovered that in two places in the globe, one in Southeast Indonesia and one in a small portion of the Smoky Mountains in Tennessee, the lightning bugs have figured out how to do something different. Instead of lighting up individually and randomly, like they do across the entire globe, these species have evolved to light up as an interconnected community, timing their pulses to the millisecond using these neurotransmitters. So when lightning bugs light up individually and randomly, their success rate of reproduction per night is 3%, which is still really good. But it turns out that when they light up as an interconnected community, they time their pulses together, their success rate goes from 3% to 82% per bug. It's not like one bug's doing really well at the new system, right? Come on, guys, keep going. This is the best night of my whole life. The entire system was doing orders of magnitude better than we thought was possible because we thought we knew how the world works. We thought it was survival of the fittest. And what we're starting to realize coming out of not only positive psychology, but the ability to have big data, is we're realizing it's not survival of the fittest, it's actually survival of the best fit. Survival of the best fit within the ecosystem of people you find yourself in. Which is why you can have people go to an incredible college, but if they don't find the right people to fit in with, they flounder while they're there. But you can go to almost any environment, and if you find the people that bring out your personal best, that you feel deeply connected to, that you like, that environment transforms dramatically for that person. And it meant something else extraordinarily important. What we keep seeing is that our own success rates at not only creating happiness, but our business outcomes, our educational outcomes, are not just related to how hard we're working on our own at our happiness or at our work, but the majority of it's predicted based upon other people. The greatest predictor of your long-term levels of happiness is your social connection score. It's the breadth, it's the depth, and the meaning in your social relationships. So the greatest predictor of your happiness is other people. So the question then becomes, how do we actually change our pursuit of happiness and success to make it with one another? By the way, this isn't just lightning bugs. Google found in Project Aristotle, if you have 100,000 different employees, if they know all the traits of the employees on the team, and they try to figure out who the superstars are with their traits, then they put those superstars onto superstar teams, then they know who are gonna be the most successful teams. They did this, 100,000 different employees, and at the end of it, they found that it didn't work. One of the researchers said that we're Google, we're amazing at finding patterns. There was no pattern in the data. There was no pattern connecting the individual traits to the long-term success rate of the team. That's stunning. What they found that was predictive was the social cohesion on the team. Do you like the people you work with? Do you have the psychological safety to voice your opinion within that system? And can you express a personal strength in the midst of that ecosystem? When those three things occurred, what we saw was a dramatic improvement, not only in the success rate of the team above the individual traits, but what we saw was how much we're better together. If we're facing big challenges, which we are, let's figure out how to find a way to transform our pursuit of happiness to do it with other people. So as you know from the Happiness Advantage and from my TED Talk or from any of the work in positive psychology, we know, for example, the gratitude exercises, if you practice scanning the world for three new things you're grateful for, can dramatically improve your levels of optimism, your positive affect, it improves your productivity, energy levels, makes your symptoms less acute, all those host of benefits. What I've been looking at is how do we do this together? So I go to a lot of companies. I've now worked with half of the Fortune 100 companies. I've worked with places like NASA and the NFL and in shanty towns in Soweto, South Africa. I've worked in the midst of cancer wards and St. Jude Children's Hospital. In all of those places, we keep finding the same thing. We keep finding, actually in a lot of environments, people that say, look, it's not part of our culture to sit around holding hands at work, you know, looking into each other's eyes and talk about things we're grateful for, right? So just give us something very hardcore that we could be doing, or we'll ask people to do this on their own. So we went out to a level one trauma hospital. We went out to a place where people were doing life or death decisions. And in their staff meetings, at all the staff meetings at Orlando Health, we got them to start each meeting where every person in the room for the staff meeting would say one thing that they were grateful for. This burned all of our social capital, right? Imagine going into a place where it's a hospital environment where people have 10, 20, 30 years of academic and academic experience or medical experience where they are surrounded by trauma. They're doing life or death decisions to decide who lives or dies based upon resource allocation. And now we're asking them to do a gratitude exercise that my son did in his pre-K class. But when we got the CEO involved, we got the leadership involved, we got each of the managers to go through and to buy into this to see how impactful it was, they started doing it. And we got them to do it for 2 weeks, which is amazing. And then they were like, well, why are we still doing it? That happiness guy's gone. And they said, no, this is part of our culture. What we believe is that happiness is an advantage. So if you believe happiness is an advantage, the very next thing you need to be asking is, what work routines am I doing to increase levels of happiness now so that me, my team, and my company can improve the outcomes that we need? Patient outcomes, patient satisfaction rates, survival rates, levels of happiness, improved burnout scores, all of that. So they kept doing it for 2 years. This is one of the things that I'm most proud of, and it wasn't me doing it. It was this hospital, Orlando Health. For 2 years, they started every meeting with one thing each person in the room was grateful for. Now, they said we had to go very quickly because, you know, we have so much to do. So whatever you do, you know, come into the meeting already having one thing that you're grateful for so we can go as fast as possible and get to our real work. So they did this. 2 years, almost to the day that we started doing this, the Pulse nightclub shooting occurred 3 blocks away from them, the second largest mass shooting in U.S. history. And you never hear this on the news, but all the victims from that worst trauma that that community has experienced came to a hospital system that for 2 years had been practicing using gratitude as a way of building up social connection and building resilience in the midst of being in a trauma hospital. The very next morning, they started their staff meetings the way that they had for 2 years, with gratitudes. And what they said that they were grateful for was universal that day. They were so grateful that they hadn't wasted the last 2 years just working with the people that they worked with. I love that, right? We can just work with the people we're working with, but that's a waste of time for two reasons. One is the greatest predictor of our success rate doing that work is our happiness levels, our social connection score, right? So if we're ignoring that, we're actually ignoring how successful that team could actually be. But also we're spending so much time with these individuals. These are the people that we want to enhance, to expand power out to defend the system together instead of trying to do this alone, lighting up individually in the dark. So now when they go out to other hospitals, they train them. If you're gonna go through the unthinkable, here's what we need you to do. Here's some emergency protocols. But before you start any of those, you actually need to start as a team going through and hearing what people were grateful for. Because it turns out as they did this, they were deepening social connection. Someone says, my kid made me pancakes this morning, I'm grateful. Something is inane in that, your brain thinks, I like pancakes, and then you feel a bond. You do this every day, it deepens those social bonds, which we found with the work that I'm doing out with the military. I got the opportunity to go out with Colonel Rideout and work with 6 battalions of Marines out at Camp Pendleton. And what we found, and that he had described to me, was how important social connection was to creating resilience in the type of soldiers that they wanted, right? It's not just you get over the hill, which is how we've always thought about success and happiness. Now what we're realizing is that it doesn't matter if just you can get over the hill, if you leave the people on your team with their communications, with your communications and your food, right? What we need to do is find a way to get the entire team over that wall or the entire team over that hill, which means we need to do this together. So that's what I invite you to do. I invite you to find some way to take your practices that you're already learning from all these incredible luminaries in positive psychology and find a way of doing it together. If you're reading a positive psychology book, do it with other people in a reading club so that you're inspired not only to do it, but you're inspired to take that information and create transformation because you realize you're not alone doing this. If you're wanting to create positive change in other people's lives, write a 2-minute positive email each day praising and thanking someone else in your life. So it's not just things you're grateful for, you're thanking other people for the impact that they've had upon your life. When we do that, it dramatically improves your social connection score. And when people do this in the morning, it triples the amount of praise they give over the course of the day. What we're finding, based upon all this research, is that maybe we need to do this stuff together. So yes, we can journal about positive experiences, but maybe after all we've been experiencing with this pandemic, is maybe we go back at the end of this with our teams and with our families, and we create little photo books of the pictures of good things that happened during this time, or the things that we were grateful for that we wrote down during these several months of challenge and crisis within people's lives, so that we could actually create a narrative for our brain that we can open up anytime we go through a challenging period within our life. And as a team, we can see how we went through a challenge, there was still meaning and beauty within it, and that we as a team were able to overcome this. And what it does is it creates a narrative of big potential. Big potential is the idea that if we want to pursue happiness and success, we have to do it with one another and not alone. Which means instead of trying to light up individually and randomly in the dark, we need to find a way of lighting up together. Which is why I think that this opportunity to be together, even virtually, is so important. And why I'm so excited to see about the positive transformations you're going to create as you start getting other people to light up with you. So I hope you have a wonderful day. I hope you're able to put this research into practice and scan for ways you can do this with your families, with your classrooms, with your teams, and with your entire companies to make this a better world to live in. And I believe we can do it. Thank you so much.